As you may have read somewhere, light only takes 8 minutes to cover the distance between the Sun and the Earth. Yes, that's an insanely short time, considering that we're talking about 150 million kilometers. But the light that reaches us is actually produced at the center of the Sun, in its core, where nuclear reactions occur. So have you ever asked yourself how long does this light take to reach the surface of the Sun, starting from its center? Well, we may attempt to find a rough estimate. Consider that the Sun has a radius of only 696,000 kilometers, compared to the 150 million kilometers that separates it from the Earth. So we would expect light to reach the surface in, let's say, a few seconds, is it? You may be surprised to hear that the estimate is totally wrong. In fact, light takes, drums, thousands of years to reach the surface of the Sun. Wait, what? How is that possible? Curious to know how? Stick with us, and we will tell you the answer in this video. Before talking about the journey of light from the center of the Sun to the Earth, we need to do a short digression about light. Stick with us, it won't be that long. What is light? Well, light is something fascinating. In fact, it has a dual nature. What does that mean? It means sometimes it behaves as a wave and sometimes it behaves as a particle. Let me tell you more. In the past centuries, scientists believed that light was a wave, and they were right. But that was only half of the story. At the end of the 19th century, and precisely in 1900, in order to explain some weird phenomenon that were puzzling scientists, the German physicist Max Planck postulated that light was actually consisting of particles called photons. Planck's idea found confirmation 5 years later, in 1905, when Albert Einstein, this guy again, managed to successfully explain the photoelectric effect by using Planck's idea. The photoelectric effect is a well-known phenomenon that occurs when light is shown at a material, metals in particular, and electrons are emitted from its surface as a result. By thinking light was a wave, some aspects of this phenomenon could not be explained. For instance, if the frequency of light was under a certain threshold, no electrons were emitted from the material, no matter how strong the intensity of the light beam is. However, by thinking light is a bunch of particles, the photons, this effect would then be explained. In fact, each photon in the light beam carries a certain amount of energy. And when the photon hits an electron in the material, it gives all its energy to the electron, which is now able to escape the material. The energy of the photon depends on the frequency of the light beam. So if this frequency is lower than a certain threshold, the photon has not enough energy to allow the electron to escape the material. The intensity of the light beam only determines the number of photons in the beam. So it doesn't matter if we increase the intensity. We only have more photons, but none of them will be able to free electrons from the material, because none of them has enough energy to do that. For realizing this, Einstein won the Nobel Prize. Now that we have realized that light consists of photons, let's go back to our original topic. Why does light take so long to reach the surface of the Sun? To answer this question, we have to start by looking at what happens in the core of the Sun. As in every other star, the core of the Sun is the motor that produces all the energy and the light emitted by our star. The mechanism by which this occurs is called nuclear fusion, which occurs only in the core of the stars, since it requires extreme conditions of temperature and pressure that are reached only here. In this process, two small nuclei of hydrogen fuse together, producing a nucleus of helium alongside with a bunch of photons. This is the beginning of their journey. Let's now focus on the exciting life of one of these photons. After this photon has been produced, the path it will follow is not straight. On the contrary, it is quite messy. The reason is that the Sun is not empty inside, instead, it is very dense. So the photons have to travel through a lot of matter before reaching the surface. In fact, our proton will travel only a microscopic distance before being captured by one of the many atoms. Ouch. Sorry, photon. Too bad. But wait, so this is the end of the story? Not at all. Before we continue to look at the journey of our photon, be sure to like or dislike the video so that we can continue to improve and make these videos better for you, the viewer. Plus, be sure to subscribe to the channel clicking the bell so that you don't miss any of our weekly videos. So we left our poor photon when it has been absorbed by an atom. What happens now? When the atom absorbs our photon, the atom gets into a particular state called excited. Think of this as a state in which the atom has an excess of energy, so it cannot bear it for a long time. In fact, very soon the atom will de-excite, re-emitting another photon, which is technically not the same photon as before. That one is long gone. Ouch. So now we ended up with a new photon. And then what happens? Well, this new photon has not a long life either. In fact, its fate is exactly the same as the original photon. It'll only travel a very short distance before being captured by another atom. This will cause this second atom to excite, and after a while to re-emit a new photon. This process will continue for several thousand times, and it happens much more frequently in the core of the Sun, which is the most dense zone of our star. As the photons proceed towards the outer layers, the density of matter decreases, which means there are less atoms able to capture the photons, and so photons are able to travel longer and longer distances before being absorbed by atoms. Eventually, when they reach the outermost layers of the Sun, the density of matter is so low, compared to the core, that photons are finally able to travel several meters or kilometers, and they can finally escape the surface of our star. Now let's imagine for a moment that the photon emitted at each step is actually the original one. By doing so, we can track down the path of the photon and see what it looks like. The result is quite bizarre. We will see that the photon follows a very chaotic track, going randomly up, down, left, right, and changing direction all the time. In fact, it does not follow any particular direction at all. So now we can understand a bit more why the photon takes so long to reach the surface. It's even easier by using an example. Imagine you have to drive from your home to your workplace, and imagine that the shortest route is by going, let's say, north for 5 kilometers. Now what happens if you keep changing direction randomly at every crossroad instead of going straight? The answer is pretty obvious. It will take you forever to reach the workplace. Maybe eventually you will reach it, but after a very, very long time. Hopefully you don't have to attend an important meeting. This is exactly what happens to our photon. Since it decided to take this very bizarre path, it will take a lot of time to escape the Sun. By comparison, if the photon could go straight to the surface, it would take only less than 3 seconds to reach it. But in reality, it takes 10 million years on average. And then what? Is the journey over? Not at all. In fact, the photon is now free to travel and reach the Earth. Since the interplanetary space between the Sun and the Earth is almost empty, there are now no atoms able to capture our photon, which is therefore free to move at its original speed, the speed of light, about 300,000 kilometers per second. Being that fast, our photon is able to reach our planet in just 8 minutes. Think about it. Thousands of years to escape the Sun, and just a few minutes to reach the Earth. But for some of the photons that were produced in the Sun, this is not even the end of the story. In fact, many of them, those who don't reach the Earth, continue their journey through the interplanetary space and even further beyond the solar system, towards distant stars and galaxies. In fact, since the space is almost empty, these photons don't find anything to interact with. And so there's nothing stopping them, so they keep traveling, free and happy. However, at this point, distances become so huge that even at their crazy speed, remember, 300,000 kilometers per second, these photons will take thousands or even millions of years to reach other stars or galaxies. At this point, it's actually interesting to look the other way around. What about photons emitted by distant stars and reaching us? Let's take, for example, a photon emitted by Proxima Centauri, the closest star outside the solar system. The star is located approximately 4.2 light years from us. It means that a photon on the surface of Proxima Centauri will take 4.2 years to reach our planet. Of course, we have to add the time it takes for the photon, which has been produced in the core of the star, remember, to reach the surface, which can be thousands of years, as we explained previously for the Sun. But right now, let's just take a photon starting its journey from the surface of Proxima Centauri, this photon will reach us 4.2 years later. Do you realize what are the implications of this?
Yes, that's right.
It means that when we look at Proxima Centauri, we are actually observing how the star looked 4.2 years ago. So it is actually correct to say that we are looking back in time. In fact, the image that we have of Proxima Centauri is the image of the star 4.2 years ago. And if you think carefully, this is even more dramatic for very remote objects. For example, take the Andromeda Galaxy, which is located 3.4 million light years from us. It means that photons coming from a star in Andromeda will take 3.4 million years to reach us. So we are looking at how the star looked like 3.4 million years ago. Crazy, isn't it? It is even possible that the star has exploded in the meantime, but we simply don't know yet, because the photons produced in the explosion haven't reached us yet, and so we are just looking at how the star was before the explosion. This is valid for every object in the universe. When we are looking at it, we are looking at how it was in the past. Think about it next time you look at a starry night sky. You're literally looking into the past. So this sounds something like going back in time. Wait, what? Now you want to talk about time travel? Yes, why not? But perhaps in another video. That's the end of the video. Thanks for watching, everyone. Did you find the photons' journey exciting? Is there something more you want to know about photons and their journey through the universe? Let me know in the comments below. Be sure to subscribe, and I'll see you next time on the channel.